So what makes the flashpoint this time around between the U.S. and Beijing and China unmanageable?
Well, of course, for the issue of Taiwan. I think it really boils down to that issue of Taiwan. For the Chinese, it is their, you know, Chinese Communist Party and President Xi Jinping. It's this historic task to basically effect that unification, whether that unification will be peaceful or not. And of course, you know, in a very indirect manner, they have already indicated the deadline. Of course, from the perspective of the United States, it's a U.S. You know, from the perspective of Washington, they could not simply allow Taiwan to fall, especially of course if China would use force against the self-governing republic. Mm. And of course, it's further complicated by the fact that the United States have allies in the region. And of course, at this point in time, from the perspective of China, they have the correlation of forces are on their side. Mm.
So is it safe to assume then that the most logical conclusion to these high level talks would only be to tone down the rhetoric?
Yeah, tone down the rhetoric and possibly find a way out at this point that, you know, they still don't know what will happen in the near future, although they already are aware of each other's intention.
Correct. And both are immovable when it comes to these intentions. You can't just expect the U.S. to all of a sudden abandon Taiwan. You can't just expect Beijing to all of a sudden abandon the Taiwan issue as well.
Oh, yes, of course. Yeah, that's a case of irresistible force versus an immovable object.
Exactly. So even if they're successful in toning down the rhetoric, I mean, is it a foregone conclusion that their intentions will remain the same and therefore actions will be taken to eventually accomplish the goal that they set out to do?
Unless, of course, you have certain black swans that would suddenly appear out of nowhere. You know, from now, of course, up to possibly roughly around 2027 or 2028. But I would put the mark at around 2027. Mm.
And so what should both sides be doing at this point, and how should the world await?
At least at this point in time, they're making each other, you know, be aware of their intention. So the United States has already indicated that, when President Joe Biden was in Tokyo last year, he inadvertently said that, you know, U.S. would, you know, send forces in case China invades Taiwan. And of course, in a recent incident, twice, you know, one during the visit of Speaker Pelosi last September, and of course, more recently, when President Tsai met Speaker McCartney in California, China already showed that it would use force. Mm. And of course, it has already the capability to do so.
Yeah, so tell me this, Professor DeCastro, if both sides are immovable when it comes to their intentions, why even hold these high-level talks?
Well, at least to manage the tension at this point in time. So you won't have any untoward incident that could, of course, ignite that forest fire. You know, a single spark might start that forest fire. South China Sea issue, what else? Senkaku, so forth and so on. Mm-hmm. You know, an incident that happened just early this month between that U.S. Destroyer and the Chinese warship in the Taiwan Strait. So at least they could possibly open channels of communication. Now, because right now, especially when it comes to mill-to-mill relationship, there's been no communication whatsoever. Mm.
All right. Talking about the U.S. now, that's happening now in Beijing, high-level talks with U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken. But then you have this agreement now between the Philippines, the U.S. and Japan agreeing to have more joint patrols, make that maritime activities in the West Philippine Sea. What signal does this give to China, and what do you think will be the corresponding action of Beijing regarding this?
Well, at this point in time, the U.S. in a way is also showing to the United States, to China, I have my allies, so I can count on my allies. So, of course, from the perspective of China, I could really take into account you have allies, but I'm simply determined to pursue and protect what I considered my three core interests, Taiwan, South China Sea, and of course, Tibet. So in a way, they're drawing the line. So if you do this, this is something that you have to take into account. that I will have allies that will provide me assistance, whether passively or actively. Mm. And of course, from the perspective of China at this point in time, let's like, wait, how China would react to this high-level meeting between the, you know, the three national security advisors of Japan, the United States, and the Philippines, signaling, of course, what I would consider the firming up of the, you know, what I call the red line in the first island chain. Mm. Because I believe this is really more of an initiative of Japan, as Japan also is trying to send a signal to China, please don't count me out. I'm, you know, a very important actor here, especially when it comes to the defense of the first island chain. Mm.
So with this, and with the U.S. managing as it is the relations between China and the U.S., would you say that the odds are stacked up against China at this point?
Well, militarily, of course, and more importantly, more significantly, of course, is that this is one of the aces of the United States. It's bilateral alliance system in the region. Not only, of course, Japan and the Philippines, you also have to factor in South Korea and, of course, Australia.
All right. Going back to this agreement now between the Philippines, the U.S. and Japan to conduct more maritime activities in the West Philippine Sea, how will this further the costs of the Philippines? How will this advance the Philippines' interest in the West Philippine Sea?
Well, it strengthened, of course, our leverage against vis-a-vis China. China will have to take into account. We don't have the United States behind us. You also have, of course, more significantly will be Japan. I think this is also a signal for the Philippines that aside from the United States that are providing us, of course, equipment, Japan will be entering the picture sooner than later.
And finally, on this topic, is this enough to undo the inaction that has happened in the past 6 years?
More significantly, of course. During when you're talking, of course, of what happened with the alliance during the time of the Duterte administration. Yeah, in a way, yes. But of course, the condition in the last 6 years is totally different right now. Mm. A lot of things have happened, of course, since 2021. You know, United States under President Joe Biden basically deciding to continue the strategic competition. You have, of course, the decision, the major decision made by the Communist Party of China last October during the 20th Party Congress of giving, of course, President Xi Jinping an unprecedented third term. And of course, announcing, you know, in a very coded message that, you know, the condition is totally different right now. China is confronted by a stormy sea, which recently President Xi Jinping again used when he did, delivered a speech to the National Security Commission of China.
All right, shifting now to another topic before we let you go. I was able to speak with you earlier this morning on another topic. We're talking about the Afghan nationals being processed here in the Philippines, that request coming from U.S. President Joe Biden himself. But as we were talking, or as we were reading the comments of our viewers at that after our interview, Professor, it seems to the public, it's very apparent that the public thinks that the processing of the Afghan nationals here in the country would lead to them getting a chunk of the pie when the pie is really so small already. They were saying there's so many problems now that are pressing. We're going to get more problems by getting them here and processing them here. There seems to be the public seems to be misinformed about this whole request. So at this point, what do you think the DFA should do to manage the situation better, manage the messaging better, Professor?
Well, at this point in time, the DFA could not simply come out with a statement because the negotiation is still ongoing. So at this point in time, the DFA would simply have to say, you know, we cannot come out with any specific regarding this matter because we're still negotiating with the United States. Mm. So the public simply would have to wait. But the fact that we know for a fact that there's a negotiation going on is an indication that there's a degree of transparency. Because again, when we talk about diplomacy, you cannot simply reveal everything that's happening on the table. Mm. So you have to give our diplomats our government officials a certain leeway, especially when you talk about diplomatic tussles regarding this matter.
But that's on the part of the diplomatic dance, right? What about taking care of things back home, explaining the issue to the public, letting them know that this is not going to make the pie smaller for them, because it's not going to happen at all? What about in that on that aspect?
Well, at this point in time, probably. I don't think, you know, based, of course, on previous experience, that the Philippine government or any other, you know, Philippine NGO, probably certain Philippine NGO, especially, of course, they get funding from the United Nations. But I don't think the Philippine government will be spending a single cent when it comes to this matter. Everything will be shouldered primarily by the United States. And chances are, of course, the United Nations Commission on Refugees.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Professor Renato De Castro there, distinguished professor at the Department of International Studies at De La Salle University. Thanks again for talking to us. Take care.
Thank you very much again, Carmina. Have a great day.
You too.